The vast majority of people who talk about politics try to think of something that the audience is going to want to hear. I do the exact opposite. I find out what crowd I'm talking to and think, what can I say that will make them a little bit uncomfortable to try to push the way they think? Because contrary to whatever every politician will tell you and most candidates and everything else, the problem isn't out there. And it's so easy to point to lots of nasty, horrible people doing nasty, horrible things out there and say they're the problem. If we could just talk them into not being nasty, the whole world gets fixed. The truth of the matter is the problem is almost always between people's ears. Even among the vast majority of people who tell me that they're for freedom and they're fighting for liberty and they believe in individual rights. Now, it would be kind of convenient if you could scream and yell and fix all the bad people out there, but the truth of the matter is, the only person you can actually fix is yourself. And what I talk about now is almost always trying to distill down what I put myself through for many years to end up with the view of reality I now have. I did lots and lots of psychological kicking and screaming along the way because I didn't want to give up a lot of the paradigms and assumptions I had my whole life. So don't think that what I say is what I started with. It's what I got to after years of looking inside my own head and realizing there's still contradictions there. And as long as there are contradictions inside my own head, I probably shouldn't be screaming at other people very much. I should probably fix that. For anyone who doesn't know, I'm an anarchist. Now, most of the anarchists I know got there by deciding that the choice between having a ruling class and not having a ruling class, it would be better to not have one. That's not how I got where I am. I got where I am by coming to the conclusion that there aren't two choices. There is no government. It's a hallucination because we imagine it to have authority that I can prove it does not have. And if we live our lives based on imagining something that isn't real, it's to be expected that we will do stupid, destructive things. As it happens in this case, the amount of evil and destruction and damage and suffering that comes from hallucinating authority where there is none is just enormous. It's way beyond my comprehension. It's way beyond the comprehension of most people I know, if not everybody. And so what I focus on is getting people to give up superstitions and hallucinations that mess with their own head. I'm going to be sort of short here in my monologue rant. My favorite thing to do, which I hardly ever get to do, is do it live, walking somebody through a line of questioning if they still believe in a government, whether it's a huge government, a little government, a constitutional republic, a democracy, whatever it is. And the reason I can't usually do it is because it's not fun to be on the receiving end of it. It wasn't fun when I was on the receiving end of it, doing it to myself. Even then I was uncomfortable. What it comes down to is freedom depends almost entirely on what is between your ears and what's between the ears of everybody else. What happens in Washington, D.C. does not matter in the slightest. It is absolutely irrelevant to whether we have a free society or not. Consider this. I realize that sounds weird if you haven't heard this sort of thing before. Consider this. What if tomorrow morning everybody in the country woke up and for some reason, by selective amnesia, they didn't know what the IRS was? And eventually they'd get letters that said, "We're the IRS and you should give us a bunch of money." And they'd go, "I don't know who you are," and they'd throw it away. That's the end of the income tax. It didn't take an election. It didn't take legislation. It took people no longer imagining an obligation to bow to a giant extortion racket. That's all. It wouldn't take a revolution. You wouldn't even have to resist. You just ignore them out of power. That's actually kind of the point of the little video, The Tiny Dive, that if you look at the number of extortionists and the number of their victims, it's just ridiculous. We outnumber them a gazillion to one. All of the power they have comes from their victims hallucinating legitimacy to the extortion racket. And it's true of every other law that the politicians want to spew forth. If we don't hallucinate an obligation to bow and obey, they just disappear. They have no power. Authority is always in the eye of the beholder. If we imagine them to be our master, then they are our master. If we stop imagining that, they aren't anymore. Literally, what do you think 400 people in Washington would do if everyone else said, we don't really acknowledge your right to boss us around and take our money? People say, well, what about their enforcers? There wouldn't be enforcers. They're hallucinating it too. All the people who work for the IRS, the soldiers, the cops, all the people who implement the destructive bad ideas of the crooks in Congress, they hallucinate authority where there is none. You think congressmen are going to go door to door saying, you got to give us some money? No, they rely on their thugs to imagine authority where there is none. And then they rely on their victims to imagine it. Now, if one or two people occasionally say, you don't have the right to take my money, you don't have the right to boss me around, in come the thugs, the very well-programmed thugs who think they're righteous and noble, stomping on people who disobey the ruling class. But if everyone understands it, it just goes away. It just evaporates. Literally, you can ignore any tyrant out of existence if enough people understand the reality. So a lot of what I do is talk to minarchists and libertarians with a capital L and constitutionalists and try to get them to see that not only will the political process never achieve freedom, and it never has before. If you want to point out an example anywhere in history, at any point in history, where voting has led to freedom, go for it. I don't know of any. Not only is that not the solution, it is the problem. And I use the analogy of the slave who every day, you know, thinks what he's going to say to his master, and he gets this eloquent, heartfelt speech of why he should be free. Every day he goes to his master and says, master, here is why you really should free me. And he goes on for half an hour while his master isn't even paying attention. His master says, yeah, get back to work. That goes on until the end of time, unless one day the slave says, I don't need his permission to be free. And then he walks away. That is what has to happen. As long as we petition and we whine for or against this or that legislation and we vote and we cry to the masters and we protest to the masters, the one message that comes through is we agree that it is up to you, masters, what we are allowed to do. Whatever you say after that, they don't hear and it doesn't matter. When the day comes that we don't go to them, we don't protest, we don't vote, we just turn our backs on them and ignore them, that's how you get to freedom, and that's the only way you ever get to freedom, because as long as you are begging the master for his permission to keep what you earn or run your own life or make your own choices, you're not even free inside your own head. As long as you imagine you need legal permission to be free, you will never be free, which is why most of what I focus on is getting people to understand the authority you hallucinate into government is not real. They are a gang of thugs, and that is all. Stop calling their commands laws. It gives it legitimacy. They aren't laws, they're threats. They boss us around and hurt us if we disobey. Stop calling their extortion taxation. It's not. It's just extortion. It's just as immoral as a carjacker or a guy on the street robbing little old ladies at gunpoint. When we stop hallucinating them as our rightful masters, they will stop being our rightful masters, because they never were. We were taught to imagine that's what they are. When people say, do you want to abolish government? I say, no, any more than I want to abolish Santa Claus. I just want people to understand it's not real. And if you will deal with your life understanding reality, things work a lot better than if your life depends upon responding to something that isn't real. That's basically my rant. I would love to have a minarchist guinea pig that I could do a few polite, nice questions to, or ask anything you want, or throw tomatoes, or whatever you feel inclined to do.
All right, so who's got a question?
Questions, questions.
Also, really quick, can you just repeat the question so that I can put this on
repeat the question in the microphone.
Sorry, Dave,
which
ahead.
Is the what? Oh, his, okay.
I'll be glad to be a guinea pig.
Excellent.
Dave Williams, guinea pig.
My short or your short?
I start.
Up and coming anarchist right here, Mr. Williams.
Okay, oh, I'll have to repeat his answer. If I mischaracterize your answer, you can throw something at me. Can a human being delegate to another human being a right that the first human being does not have?
No.
Can two human beings delegate to a third a right that neither of the first two have?
No.
Where did Congress get their rights to do anything?
It's on Dixon.
All right. Hey, you pretended to be a minarchist.
Cheater!
I'm the former state chair of the Libertarian Party. You're talking about those contradictions in your head?
Yep.
I've got them too.
Good, good. But you seem to be recovering nicely from it. So, any guinea pigs who will suffer more?
I have an honest question that I kind of struggle with.
Okay.
I accept the fact, and although I was homeschooled, you know, I was raised that government was packed by we're all programmed by media that government exists, because you see shows like Law and Order, and you watch movies, and there's the CIA, and they have secret things going on, and you get this perception of this monolith that is government, and that almost makes it tangible. So, when it comes to basically spreading, and growing the numbers and swelling our so-called base, a lot of times I feel compelled to address people where they're coming from. And people are coming from a status perspective, which I kind of still have myself sometimes because I've put forth the quandaries from people, and Justin and I were just discussing this, where essentially they have practical and pragmatic questions that are somewhat difficult to answer. And so sometimes when trying to bridge that gap, for instance, I feel compelled to share with people the fact that there is more than one presidential candidate.
I really agree with a lot of that. I mean, I came there that way. Most of the people I know who came there, you know, either by way of Ron Paul or some other kind of political version. I guess what I'm really saying, because, yeah, I did that too, and I'm glad that was there to nudge me there. I'm saying when people get pushed to the edge of the political system, don't stop. Kick them off the edge. And so it's Ron Paul's job to push them to me and my job to try to push them over the edge. But yeah, there's that transition in almost everybody I know who ended up giving up statism entirely, that first they had to think about it and say, well, we should, I mean, really, my wife Tessa and I, we nudged each other over the edge over a matter of years because we kept trying to define a government that was legitimate. Well, it can't the taxes have to be voluntary, in which case they're called contributions, not taxes. And they wouldn't have a monopoly, because if you wanted to hire that guy to protect you, then... And we whittled it away and said, there, that's legitimate, and it's not government anymore. And so I think a lot of people have to go through that, starting inside the political mindset. However, I do know a lot of people who are getting there in one shot now. And if you would have told me 10 years ago that would happen, I would say, no way. Nobody can do it in one shot. I get almost an email a day saying, I read The Most Dangerous Superstition, and a week later my entire view of reality was changed. And I did not nearly do that myself, and the first zillion times I heard it, I said, really? I mean, do you really get it, or does it sort of sound fun, and so you're saying you agree? And so I'll ask the people, and they really get it. I don't know why suddenly people can do that, because I don't know anybody who did that 5 or 10 years ago, and now they're just, you know, they're just piling off the cliff into giving up statism. None. Do I have to repeat the question? By the way? No, I totally sympathize with the concern. Here's why I say none. Why I say there is no, like a lot of people say, well, we have to get there gradually, and I'm not saying this is what you said, but a lot of people say, well, we have to get there gradually or nudge people in that direction. There isn't actually a direction between somebody else owns you and you own yourself. It's one or the other. It's digital. The entire analog scale of Gary Johnson to Barack O'Romney has nothing to do with freedom or philosophy. It's just how nice do you want your master to be. This actually came up in a fun little panel discussion we had at Libertopia with his VP candidate, Judge Jim Gray, to vote or not to vote, which is already posted from the Libertopia that just happened. The thing is, there is no, you can't get to there by getting a nicer master. And to say, I want a guy who's going to let me keep more of my money and let me keep my guns and let me make more of my choices and let me smoke pot, really, you know, in a practical sense, and I say this all the time, If I had to be owned by somebody, I wouldn't mind being owned by Ron Paul, because I bet he would be pretty nice to me. But that is not good enough for me, and it shouldn't be good enough for human beings. I don't want a nicer master who will give me permission to be free, because that is no closer to being free, any more than a slave being purchased by a different slave master who doesn't work him as hard and lets him do more stuff. He isn't one inch closer to being free, even if in his daily life he's more comfortable and he gets to keep more stuff and he feels like he has more freedom. The underlying lie is still there that he is the property of someone else. And as long as the belief in government remains, that is people believing they are the property of somebody else. If you think somebody else gets to decide tax rates, in other words, somebody else gets to tell you how much of what you earn you keep, the fact that he says you get to keep 90% instead of you get to keep 50% may make you comfortable on a more comfortable on a practical level, but you are no closer to being free. In fact, in a sense, you're farther away, because the more painful it gets, the more people are able to consider maybe the whole thing is a joke. I was just talking a second ago. A smart tyrant in this situation would do across-the-board tax cuts, repeal all sorts of laws, and back things up and say, you have my permission to be free to keep the lie stuck in people's heads that government is legitimate and you should obey their laws and pay their taxes. Instead, luckily, every tyrant does the giant mistake. It's what makes every empire fall. They see it starting to slip and they lurch forward to try to grab it all. When they do that, it means they're losing the battle of philosophy and ideas, and you cannot enslave 300 million people by brute force, especially when 100 million of them have guns.
Elliot.
So are you arguing that you are free today and that any idea that you're not free is an illusion, or are you saying that you are not free today?
I'm free in here. There are people outside of me who inflict threats upon me. Most of them call them laws and government. But I do not acknowledge any rightful master over me. And the slave that understands that he is not the property of anybody else is way ahead of the slave who's owned by a nice master.
So here's the thing. So you're simply saying that any sort of person who says that they have an obligation upon you has no moral validity. Is that what you're limiting to? In that you are actually, in your opinion, are free today apart from any sort of fictitious obligation as imposed?
It's his opinion that he's free. It's his opinion.
Yeah, and I can impose obligations on myself by agreeing to do something with it. Yeah. But yeah, somebody who claims to be authority over me, he's lying. And if I can get away with disobeying him, I have no obligation to obey.
And so then the reason why you support anarchy is in your opinion.
I don't support anarchy any more than I support abolishing Santa. It's what is.
Okay, the reason why you are opposed to having an organized system of government, if I'm correct, are you opposed to an organized system of government?
There is no such thing as government.
So how do you define the current system of laws regardless of legitimacy?
Gang of thugs making crap up.
The reason why you're opposed to the current gang of thugs making crap up that we have today, in your words, not saying I agree with it, but in your words, is because they are a greater proximity to reducing your ability to act in the ways that you want of your life as if those thugs were empowered, or why are you opposed to that?
Because no human being can have the right to rule another.
But there's always going to be...
No, there will not.
There will always be people who want to take your stuff.
Yeah.
The difference is that what we have now is greater control over them of what we will have
than
we do not have voting and we do not have democracy.
There will always be people who want to take your stuff. The difference is you imagine that some of them are legitimate.
No, I don't. No, I'm not imagining they're legitimate. I'm imagining or not imagining that I have a greater degree of control over them than what we would have in a so-called state of anarchy.
Really? You have a control over Congress.
I have more control over them than we would have in a system.
Great. Let's test that hypothesis. Get them to give you a 1% tax cut. Ready? Go.
Get your system of multiple mafias to not kill you. Go. See, the thing is, you want to look at
Do I look dead?
All the costs of other systems. You're creating a fictitious test. You're loading the dial on one side.
No, I just demonstrated you have no control over Congress.
I just demonstrated that your other system, you have no control
it's
over
It's not a system.
It is.
Right. It's an absence of a ruling class.
There will still be people who are trying to inflict harm upon them, and you have no control over them.
Okay, so
you have no
control. I have more control over here than you have over there. So
no, you absolutely don't.
No, you absolutely do not.
You don't even have control over your own mind because you imagine you need to.
I never am assuming a legitimacy here. I never said it's legitimate. I'm saying.
Wow! Can we get that on record?
Whoa! Of course that.
Oh my God!
You called it government. Government means it has authority.
No, that's the definition you're imposing upon it.
That's what the word means.
Is that your idea of anarchy, your idea of, call it what you will, call it anarchy, call it lack of government,
how about understanding reality?
Organization of gang of thugs, it's still going to result in more force being applied to you than what we have today.
What? Tell me this. If tomorrow 300 million people don't feel an obligation to obey the IRS, do you think the IRS will have more power or less power?
We're going to have the IRS with less power. We'll have something else take its place.
Really?
Yes, we will.
And what will this gang look like that can forcibly rob 200 million people who don't feel an obligation to obey?
Something like the state of nature in Thomas Hobbes.
Oh!
So we'll be more robbed if we stop imagining that someone has the right to rob us.
It has nothing to do with imagining rights. It has to do with
it has everything.
Someone is actually going to rob you.
It has everything to do.
It has nothing with legitimacy. You're focusing on legitimacy as the fundamental question.
It is.
This is irrelevant.
Wait.
The question is, there's power to minimize the force.
Okay.
Who's imposing whose definitions here?
Wait. That's a really good question. But hold on. Stop.
Go ahead.
Everybody always wants to know who will build the roads, who will be the defense agency.
Elliot,
you're talking about defense agencies.
No, I'm talking about whether someone, forget about defense agencies. I'm not saying anyone has to defend you. I'm saying if you do not have this gang of thugs, will not another gang of thugs take its place, or multiple gang of thugs war over you and you get caught.
As long as people hallucinate authority, yes. But if you actually think that 100,000 human beings, that's all there are at the IRS, the entire IRS has about 100,000 employees, 2,000 of them are armed, the rest are paper pushers. If you really and truly believe that 2,000 armed people can continually rob 200 million people every year who don't feel an obligation to obey them, you are delusional.
And what's going on with Las Zetas in Mexico? What's going on with all the different...
Nice change of topics. Do you imagine...
Here's the thing. You're so focused on authority and legitimacy, but you ignore the fact that if you get rid of authority and legitimacy, you're just going to have a different group of gang of thugs fighting over stuff, and your freedom and your property and your life is still going to be restricted.
So you don't think...
It's a difference of proximity of threats.
No. So you don't think that the fact that 100 million victims of the IRS extortion racket... Imagining it to be legitimate, you don't think that's the driving force behind the income tax?
I think that drives the income tax, but I don't think that's what's driving the fundamental question, which has to do with you avoiding people impinging your freedom and liberty and your ability to act. That's the question. Legitimacy, authority, that's all non sequiturs. The question is, how do you get to maximize your freedom and people getting in your way? And the fact of the matter is, you're so focused, you're so fixated and obsessed with authority and legitimacy, you ignore the fact that there are other things that would inevitably arise.
They're utterly trivial. They're utterly trivial.
Elliot, you don't believe in the free market? You don't think that the market works? You really think the government is better than the market? Is that what you're saying?
What I am saying is that the free market relies upon the rule of law, and if the free market only works
with a retarded area of government?
You know what?
Free relies on domination.
Elliot, your questions are over. Jesse, please ask another question. Thank you for participating.
Well, most of that I agree with, except the damage to be done is not to Washington. We're not going to make them worse. It doesn't make the slightest bit of difference to them what we do. But the damage to other people who say they want freedom if we teach them that begging the masters is a legitimate and useful thing to do. And it doesn't, if it ever had a track record of, on a practical level, reducing tyranny, I could sort of sympathize with that, except it doesn't ever.
But the difference is that the people that are involved evolve with the political process today, they're still under that illusion anyway. We might as well interact in their world and try and pull them from it, rather than sitting on the outside throwing rocks at it.
But you can't pull them from it, from playing their game. Like, if you go in and say, I'm going to vote for somebody...
From it, he might have pulled you from it, probably pulled plenty of other anarcho-capitalists from it, as did a lot of other people playing in that system. You know, people have been affected by some libertarian leaders that have pulled people from it. And I guess in this election cycle, and not that the election means a lot to me, but I think this election cycle was much better off with the Ron Paul and Gary Johnson than with Dickhead A and B. I think it's better to have them there, at least telling people it's not wrong for people. It's not okay for people to take your stuff. It's not okay for people to beat you down when you disagree with them or put you in cages for having the wrong kind of plant or whatever. There's people that aren't. It would be like, if we could have like 5 ANCAP channels on TV, would we be better off? Even though TV's corrupt and messed up and is controlled, that would be a good way to get our audience.
What about the megaphone? He's kind of giving the megaphone argument.
Yeah, and that I totally sympathize with. Like, I think Ron Paul did a ton to push people in the direction of thinking about actual philosophy. As far as the campaign and pushing buttons, it didn't do anything. But because he was out there and people hearing him, people starting to think about it, that did a lot. But there's actually an inherent contradiction to say, we're going to play politics and by the way, you're free. Because how many people are, and I know a lot of people who started in that contradiction and started being interested and then fell off the political spectrum entirely. So I'm not the one who came up with this, but I like to refer to Ron Paul as a gateway drug. He nudges people in the direction of all the way giving up authoritarianism.
I started there too, though, from the same perspective of looking at like Ron Paul from the perspective of like, okay, his actions don't match his words, he's teaching freedom, but then he's using the force and coercion of government to do things. But then if you look at it from the perspective of anybody filling that spot would use more force and coercion, and yes, we can take the moral position and say we're not going to participate in that at all because it's wrong. No one's watching. Nobody gives a shit if we do that. Whereas when Ron Paul does sit in that spot and minimize and keep the least amount of damage coming, and then he gets the benefit of the soapbox, it's better than having his competitor in that box from a game theory perspective. And I do think there is something to be said. And one thing I want to summarize real quick, the last argument you were just up against is essentially that your anarchy sucks because it could end up being my statism.
Being government. Right. It'll just turn into government. Nice spread.
The worst thing that could happen is that we get a government.
Let me say a quick thing. I agree with almost all of that, except I do think when we legitimize the system, we're handicapping the people who would otherwise be on the side of freedom. And I do know some people who started on the, including me, who started in the political activist thing and then fell off the spectrum entirely. So it does push people that way. As far as the game theory thing, I think the best thing we could possibly have is the biggest tyrant in the world on the throne to crash the thing into the ground as soon as possible.
I agree.
John,
you know, rather than draw it out. Okay, we got millions of questions.
Zog, get him.
You can decide which first, because I wouldn't pay attention to
you. Go ahead, John.
I agree with you. The IRS is delusional. I figured that out 25 years ago, and I have not filed or paid income taxes since.
Yeah! Yeah!
You pay taxes to the delusional IRS.
Now I'm so poor I don't have to. I was put in a cage for a year for not doing it. And I'm happy to say that I cost them way more than they stole from me in the process. Right now I have that convenient advantage of being so poor that even they know I don't owe them anything, which has its disadvantages. If I ever actually have enough that they think I'm supposed to pay, I'm going to have to decide. I think there are other ways to make sure I use up more of their resources than I give them. I may have to settle for that, like playing inside their game, but we'll see if I'm ever rich enough to have to care about that again. Yep.
Do you pay sales tax?
Yeah, and I don't. You know, well, when I can get around it, no.
I have another question. So what I struggle with is, as an anarcho-capitalist, is I just don't want to be bothered. And doing a cost-benefit analysis, you know, I drive at speed limit or relatively close to speed limit. I pay my sales taxes, my income taxes, just because, and I'm a business owner, so I just don't want to be bothered, so.
Yeah, it's self-preservation is no sin. You know, I know some people who just hurl themselves against the beast and say, I won't do anything, and I sympathize with them, and I know some people who say, you know, I go along with a lot of it because I don't want to be tased or shot or anything else. To me, the underlying philosophy is what matters the most, and if that can spread, eventually it doesn't matter how much you put up with today and how much you don't. The thing is, if people feel, if everyone lost their feeling of obligation to bow, then we all stop and it just goes splat. But in the meantime, yeah, I know lots of people who compromise and go along with lots of stuff, including me. Like, there's lots of things that I don't get into a shootout over, which I don't feel they have a moral obligation to impose on me. And to me, that's the thing, is when people give up that, then tyranny falls. And it's just like, and I often say this, it sounds a little bit mean, but that's because it is. I view people with badges like rabid dogs. There's something wrong with their brain that makes them very dangerous, so when I'm around them, I don't make sudden moves, I'm quiet, and I usually do what they expect me to do so they don't rip my throat out. It's not because I imagine them to be my rightful master, it's because I want my throat still attached to the rest of me. And if everyone gets to the point where they understand that, then it's really easy to take it down, which is why instead of going, let's go resist and blah, 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 I try to get people to understand you are not beholden to these people. They are not your rightful masters. These are not laws. These are not taxes. They're just threats from thugs. Because when enough of us understand that, we don't have to bow to their garbage to save our own necks anymore. But yeah, I don't at all blame people for trying to stay alive in a society that, for the most part, thinks we're the property of the politicians. To me, the weirdest thing that I see happening now, and I don't know why, like, when I look back at my own history of struggling and trying to hang on to the Constitution and trying to hang on to limited government, trying to hang on to authority, I don't know what made me after years just go, I don't really need that anymore, and own myself. And of the literally thousands of people I now know who have gone through that, you know, at different speeds and from different positions, I know, you know, self-avowed socialists who turned into anarcho-capitalists, and everything along the spectrum, I still can't figure out why people make that choice. Like, all I can do is try to put ideas in front of them, but there are some people who want this much government, and 15 years later, they'll be screaming their heads off that, no, we have to have that much, I'm not letting go. And then there are other people who you talk to for a couple weeks and they go, yeah, it's all bogus, man. And they let go. I don't know what it is that makes that happen. What I do know is it's speeding up a lot. Like 10 years ago, I've been saying the same things for 16 years. And 10 years ago, I knew maybe 6 people who would call themselves anarchists. Now I know 6,000 at least. And it's been going on a curve. I don't know why. I don't think it's from what I'm saying. I don't even think it's from like Stefan Molyneux, you know. Every nudge helps, but there seems to be an essential huge thing going on that all of a sudden people are able to think past the scale of what kind of master should we have to, why do we need a master? And that last step to me is all that matters. The entire bickering over how big our master should be done, it completely misses the point. But now there are lots of people stepping over that line. And I don't know why, but I'm thrilled about it, so I keep screaming about whatever I can scream about, and just watch it happen. Yep. Right, and she was saying that the non-aggression principle is just sort of a world changer for a lot of people, and that's been around. I mean, that's been the basis of libertarianism for ages. And the funny thing to me, which shows the power of the delusion of government, is if you ask them, "Do you think it's okay to initiate violence against another human being?" Everybody says no. But if you say, well, does that mean you're not voting anymore? Well, no, in that case, you have to. So it's something almost everybody instinctively understands. They know it's right, they know it's civilized, but they imagine there's this huge exemption for the thing called government. And they so much believe it that they don't even notice when you, because I often get before a crowd and say, I promise never to initiate violence against any of you or advocate that anyone else do it. Who here is going to agree? Everybody's hand goes up, and then I say, okay, that means you don't vote anymore because you know whoever you vote for is going to demand my money under threat of caging me, and all the hands go down. And hopefully some people start to think about it. But yeah, when somebody all the way grasps the non-aggression principle, it's so simple and obvious. And that's the thing. Most of what I do is not explaining really complex things. It's how do you explain things that are so painfully simple that every four-year-old should understand them, but they've been bashed out of our heads through authoritarian indoctrination. Yeah, this the lie is hugely complicated. The truth is painfully simple. I'll always bring this up. Oh, you get rid of it, you'll have another one. As long as people believe in authority and government, absolutely, which is why the belief is what has to go. And until it does, even if this one puts itself out of business and crashes, economic disaster, whatever it does, you know, Soviet Union, Rome.
Oh, no, I would agree. I would say that the impact community and the liberty movement, what we need to do is we need to get to that finish line before the state fully collapses.
Yeah.
So
yeah.
That we can avoid a new one.
It will be a very, very unique, never say very unique, it'll be a very unique situation. When this empire falls on its face and gives the people who actually believe in freedom a chance to live it without getting run over by tanks and blown up by drones and stuff. Yeah. And when people ask me, you know, well, you really think there will ever be a society without government? Absolutely, 100% guaranteed, for the same reason that it was inevitable that eventually we'd know the earth isn't flat and the sun doesn't go around us, it's the other way around. The evidence will be there forever. Now, lots of nasty, horrible things might happen in the meantime. It may take years and years and years. But eventually, the bleeding obvious wins out over the complicated lie, and that will be the same with the lie called government. Sooner or later, everyone's going to look back on today and say, wow, they actually imagined that a group of human beings had the right to boss everybody around. They will look at our constitutional republic the same way we look at the notion of divine right of kings. Oh, some watery tart lobbed a scimitar at you and suddenly you have the right to rule. How we look at that is how the future will look at politics today.
Give it up!
Give it up for the room.
All right, I know that some of the statists in the room had their interest piqued, so I would encourage you to check out Larken's book, The Most Dangerous Superstition, because it certainly is dangerous and a superstition.